everybody, and welcome back to From This Corner TV. And I'm Marilyn Dayton, your host once again. And tonight we're going to take what we started last week when we talked about breast cancer and the Terry Brito Breast Cancer Foundation. We're going to take it just a little bit further, a little bit more detail, because I don't know if you realize it or not, but most of New England has the highest breast cancer incidence in the country, and it's higher by quite a bit. So that's why it's so important that we talk about it. And I'm very lucky tonight that I've got our friend Dawn Swope back tonight with us, and she's our co-host. And welcome back, Dawn.
Thank you. Glad to be here.
And we have a special guest that I know from the Terry Brito Breast Cancer Foundation. Her name is Pamela Watt. And she is a breast cancer survivor and a volunteer at the Terry Brito Breast Cancer Foundation. Thank you for being with us tonight, Pam.
Thank you for having me.
I'm very excited to hear your stories. Now, last week you heard about the fact that Dawn had something called triple negative. And that, of course, went right by my head. So I want to know a little bit more about that. I'm sure you do, too. So, Dawn, can you start us out with explaining a little bit more about what that means?
Yes. Triple negative breast cancer is a breast cancer. It's aggressive and it's fast moving. And unlike other breast cancers, it's non-hormone receptive. And what that means is once you finish treatment, there are no drugs to sort of slow the growth of cancer cells that could be roaming around in the body.
So it's you can't take the drugs like tamoxifen and the others? You can't take those drugs?
That's correct. It just doesn't work for us.
Now, most people think, you got breast cancer, okay, so you take that nasty drug called tamoxifen, and you're good. But that's not true.
That's the case, right.
Now, Pam, you also found that you had this type of cancer?
I'm also triple negative, yes.
Wow. Tell us how you found out.
I had a mammogram in February 2008, and it came back no suspicious findings. And a month later, I found a lump and began to investigate. And by June of 2008, I was diagnosed with stage 2 breast cancer, two types. I had DCIS, which is ductal carcinoma in situ, and also invasive ductal carcinoma when it invades out. And stage 2 is between 2 and 5 centimeters.
And this is a month after you had your mammogram?
Yes.
Wow.
Goodness.
Yes.
Okay, what we need to learn from that, people, is, yes, get your tests done, whatever type that you want, ultrasound, mammogram, thermography, but check yourself every single month, and sometimes twice a month, right?
Yes.
So then what happened?
Well, I immediately went for a lumpectomy, and The next 3 years were filled with surgeries. I had 4 months of intensive chemo, 7 surgeries, and probably, I can't even count how many procedures, medical procedures that I went through.
Why so many procedures?
Along with being triple negative, I was also diagnosed as being BRCA2 positive, which is the positive for the breast cancer gene, which predisposes one to breast cancer at 80% for an overall lifetime chance, and then a 50% reoccurrence. Also a percentage of, I think it's 40% for ovarian, and then there's a 3 to 6% chance of pancreatic and melanoma. So with that said, it brought about a bunch of other decisions for me.
Now, do you have a family history?
No history at all.
And yet you have
I'm the history.
Oh, you're setting the pace.
I'm setting the pace,
yes. Oh boy, wow. Now, did you have a family history at all?
I didn't discover that I had the family history till later. So it was kind of a shock for us all when it was all of a sudden everybody remembered that somebody at some time had the breast cancer and the ovarian cancer, and it was a first cousin. So I started the process of the gene testing, and that's on file for any of my family members who need it.
Okay. It seems like, of course, we're grateful to people like Angelina Jolie, who put this gene in the news. But keep in mind, people, that you don't have to have a family history.
No, you don't.
It can still happen. So that's, it's still important to go through the tests and check yourself. Now, let me ask you this. Are either one of you in any kind of treatment at all? Are you still, well, you said that you were being checked every 3 months, now every 4 months, correct?
That's correct. I'm actually part of a study. I'm taking metformin. I don't know if I'm actually taking the study drug or the placebo. But they have found, and I think we, if you've heard the news, they're using it for several types of cancer. They find that those who are taking the metformin, which is a drug for diabetics, have a lower incidence of cancer. So there's a huge study going on right now. I'm at Yale as part of the study. So there's no treatment, but they're still looking for ways to treat this type of cancer and other cancers.
And Pam, are you on any kind of studies or tests, or how often do you go get checked?
I get checked every 6 months. I see the oncologist and the surgeon every other 6 months.
Okay.
I'm not on any drugs or any kind of current treatment, and I also treated at Yale as well.
Wow. Yay, Yale. Okay.
Excellent treatment at Yale.
Now, I asked last week, Dawn, how this changed your life. I'd like to ask the same question of you. Pam, how did this change your life?
It changed my life in many ways. You're just never the same after diagnosis.
Right.
I actually got involved with the Terry Broder Breast Cancer Foundation, and I counsel various women on my own, and caregivers as well.
It's a very emotional disease.
It
isn't
is. It is very emotional.
And when you think about it and talk about it, it stays emotional, because this is a disease that scares the life out of you. It does. And you said that you are involved with Terry Broder Breast Cancer Foundation. When did that happen, and how did that happen?
When I was diagnosed in 2008, my friends and family formed a team called Pam's Pink Posse, and they walked in support of my fight. I waited for them at the finish line because I was going through chemo. And I met Sandy Maniscalco, who's one of the founders of the foundation, and her husband, Phil, and another couple, the Brent Silvers. And the love and care and support that they extended to me on that day was just overwhelming, but I knew that it was an organization that I needed to be part of.
And you couldn't walk that day because of the chemo, but you had this team. And say it a little bit louder so people can enjoy the name.
It's Pam's Pink Posse.
Pam's Pink Posse.
Wonderful.
I love that.
We've walked for 6 years now. I've walked five. I've done the full marathon 5 years in a row. And we've had, the team started with 8 people, and we've varied amongst the years. And this past year we had 8 people again, so it was really kind of nice.
That's wonderful.
That's wonderful. I'm glad to see that. And we have a 4-minute video that we would like to show you. And as you watch this, open your heart to what you see, because you're going to feel a lot of emotion. That day of the walk is unbelievable. The support, the love, just watch this tape and see what you think.
My mom is a breast cancer survivor of 7 years, so that's why I'm here today.
My wife is a 2-time cancer survivor.
One of our co-workers had breast cancer, and we're doing this also in honor of her.
We're here today in honor of my mom, Judy Coughlin, who passed away of breast cancer.
This is our third year.
in support of our mother-in-law.
My best friend, Lisa LaFemina, had breast cancer, and she passed away on September 4th. And so we're here in her memory, walking for her, celebrating life for her.
This is a great organization because the money goes 100% to research.
I love the fact that it's 100% towards the researchers.
We've looked into doing other walks for even other benefits, and a lot of them weren't 100% of proceeds.
Yeah.
So.
That video, and of course I recognize quite a few people in there, it touches me. I've never had breast cancer and hope I never do. And you know, I still don't know an awful lot about it, even though, you know, we hear about the, you know, the gene and how that's involved, and we're learning more and more every day. But you two, having gone through it, you can maybe explain and enlighten us a little bit more. It's not just breast cancer. There's so many different types. And you said that you had triple negative, which you said also was rare. It's fairly rare.
Yes, it is. I think it's around 10 to 15%.
Correct.
That actually have it. Usually there is the family history surrounding that type of cancer.
But you learned a lot through this process. Can you explain a little bit about this disease that just, you know, it just flies over our heads, and even though there's more and more being known every day, can you explain it just a little bit better? I know I'm probably putting you on the spot, but
I think that you definitely need to be proactive in your treatment and have knowledge on your disease. And I think it's very important to maintain a positive attitude to get through the fight.
Yes.
Have a good support system.
Now when you, and of course we just saw that, a lot of that support system right there in that video. When you mean investigate, research, become more familiar, do you mean get on Google and go to town?
Yes and no, because you have to be careful what websites you actually get your information from. Mm-hmm. But you want to understand what triple negative means, whether you're estrogen positive or negative, and your what stage you are, different types of chemo. With my case, I was stage one initially, and then there were some decisions that needed to be made. And when I asked for the tumor board at Yale to review my case, it came back that I was actually stage two, when they actually really got down into it, because I was borderline. And that determined a different type of chemo that I had to have. So I had to have the something called AC plus T, which is the harshest type that you could possibly have, which I'm sure that's
I did too.
The kind that you had had.
Yep.
You know, you lose your hair, and you normally have to have a port put in, because it cannot go through your veins. It has to go through the port. So
it'll ruin your veins.
Oh, wow.
So you have to put it directly in.
Oh, man.
And it, you know, you end up with a chemo fog. You tend not to remember some things. You, depending on your age,
right.
Forced right into menopause at, you know, a young
yes.
age, which is really not so fun.
Yep. How old were you?
41 when I was diagnosed.
Wow. My daughter's 40, and I was talking to her the other day about getting her mammogram, and she said she mentioned it to her doctor, and her doctor said, "Oh yeah, you can do it sometime, you know, in the next year." And my daughter looked at me and said, "I don't think I'm going to wait. Do you think I should wait?" I said, No. Now, how old were you, Dawn, when it happened?
If I remember correctly, it was 3 years ago. I was 44. And part of the decision-making, I took control with my diet. I did the research I needed to do and decided on a bilateral mastectomy. It wasn't something that was suggested, but it was something that I decided to improve my recovery and survival as much as possible, to just do the bilateral, to have both breasts removed. Then there's the whole decision of reconstruction, which is not as easy as it sounds. It's a long process. It's very uncomfortable. But it really, it's about taking control, like Pam said, taking control of your situation, making decisions for yourself along with your doctor, not just letting everybody make decisions around you. You have to have enough knowledge to participate in your recovery. It's so important. And definitely is having the positive attitude. You have to just decide that at that moment, you're going to live every day to the fullest, no matter what's happening. And you have to try and release that need to know what's going to happen, which is really difficult. But it's about just enjoying every second and not letting anything ruin those moments, however many moments you have left. You know, you could walk off the curb and get hit by a bus. We just don't know.
That's true.
So we take control of your...
You know, that's one of the things that is the theme of tonight. We're going to talk a little bit about the different stages you go through, especially when you're faced with a disease like this. You lose control. All of a sudden, your control is taken away by a disease, by doctors, by the insurance company, nice. Which has to be in there and involved. And when do you start feeling like you're getting control back over your body? When does that happen?
I don't know if it's necessarily control over your body, but I definitely took control of the situation. And like I said, I did my research, I made my decisions, many of the same ones that Dawn had made. And I think, you know, it's basically been probably the last year to year and a half that I finally feel that I'm healthy, I'm active, and I think I'm really finally at peace with the changes that cancer has brought about in my life, and I'm trying to give back with the knowledge that I've obtained.
Well, that's very important, because the rest of us that haven't been through this, it's hard for us to understand. And we can be supportive, and we can read about it, but we just don't understand because we haven't been there. And sometimes the initial reaction from other people is not really what you would expect.
That's true.
Did you get some really weird reactions from people when you shared the diagnosis?
Some people get scared. They don't know what to do, so they just leave you alone. And it's really hard to not take that personally, but you sort of process it and understand that everybody handles it differently. People sometimes don't know what to do. And when I was first diagnosed, may I share this?
Yes, please.
At first, when I was diagnosed, I didn't want anybody to know. I was going to wear a wig. I wasn't going to tell anybody because I didn't want anybody to look at me any differently. And I had my real hair wig, and oh my gosh, I'm so sorry.
That's okay.
And
there you go.
Oh, thank you. But somebody said to me, but people want to help you. That's not fair that you take away from the people who are going to find out about this. And there's people who need to help, they need to support you. And so for me, it became about trying to educate everybody around me, because it's less scary when you can see the process. And that was part of my control, was opening up to people and letting them see what it's really like to be diagnosed with breast cancer, what it feels like to be scared, what it feels like to be faced with, you know, am I going to make it? And in that process, part of that control was donating my hair to Locks of Love and shaving my head. So
I even remember seeing, there was a sports figure, I can't remember his name, and I apologize for that. His wife was diagnosed with breast cancer, and she lost her hair. So, and they had a son. So the husband and the son both shaved their heads in support of their wife, mother, which I thought was it was very touching.
I think that shaving your head is actually really taking control. I think it's very important, and I suggest that to many people that go through treatment, because then you take control. Losing your hair is scary, and when you wake up and there's pieces on the bed, or there's long pieces or short pieces, it really makes it more traumatic, I think.
Even shaving your head.
And shaving your head was it was a tough day. I remember the day that I could pull it out. I had already cut it short.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And then there was coming out in pieces. And I had a couple of friends come over, and two people shaved, one female, one male, shaved their heads along with mine. Yeah. And but it was still very traumatic. But yet, I took control because I didn't have to wake up every day and have pieces on the pillow.
Absolutely.
And I think that's important to be in control.
Absolutely. That's.
And I never wore my wig.
I never did
either. I presented myself as whatever I was at that time.
Right. I think I bought the wig just as you were saying. I had all full intentions on wearing it. I think I wore it to work one day, and I said, I can't wear this. I said to my coworker, I don't feel comfortable wearing this. And she said, do what you want to do. And I didn't wear it. I just wore a wrap, and that's how it was.
I have a friend who went through breast cancer about 16 or 17 years ago. Her name is Molly, and she's just a most wonderful person. And her hair never really grew back. She has some hair, and you know, people ask her, well, why don't you put a hat on? Why don't you put a wig on? Why don't you know? And she says, this is who I am. This is who I am, and I've been through a lot to deserve me. And so there you go. It doesn't mean that she's happy about it, but she accepts it, her children accept it, her husband accepts it, it's who she is. And when you've been through a life-threatening disease, there's nothing better than waking up alive every morning and
Absolutely.
Looking in the mirror and saying, I'm here, I'm back, another day, and I'm going to make it a damn good one.
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
This has been a pleasure. I wish we could sit here and talk all night.
I know.
Dawn, thank you. She's going to be with us in the second half, too. Pam, thank you for coming
thank
on
you.
The show.
Thank
and
you very
much. I will look for you at our upcoming Terry Broda Breast Cancer Foundation walk and any events that we have. I will look forward to seeing you
I'll
there,
be
too.
There. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. We will be back after a short break, and we're going to have Kimberly and Derick Brito, who are going to continue this discussion about taking control of your body, your health, everything. So we'll be back in a couple of minutes.
The average text takes your eyes off the road for nearly 5 seconds.
Can you help me with this? My new dad teaches me all kinds of stuff.
Sure.
He helps me with homework.
That would be 3.6795.
Thanks.
Yep.
He helps me with my decision making.
I wouldn't use this one. Ever.
And he's even teaching me how to drive.
And that's why cars have bumpers.
I'm learning so much.
You don't have to be perfect to be a perfect parent. Thousands of kids in foster care will take you just as you are.
All right, you ready for some baseball trivia?
Let's do it.
What year produced the most no-hit games in the big leagues?
7 no-hitters in 1990.
Wow, that's right. Now a question that's not trivial. How many children will witness bullying this year?
Huh.
The answer? 3 out of 4.
75%?
That's wow. Right. How many of them will say something?
Kids want to help, but don't know how. Teach them how to stop bullying and be more than a bystander at stopbullying.gov.
There's a shelter pet who wants to meet you. Meet one today. Visit theshelterpetproject.org. Adopt.
And welcome back. And thank you for being with us tonight. That was a very touching and emotional first half.
Yes, it was.
And thank you, Dawn, very much for opening up.
Thank you.
I like to get into things a little bit. And not that I'm looking to do a lot of controversial shows or anything, but you know what? The more informed you are, the better your life can be. And that's the way I feel, so that's the way we're going to continue the second half. Because so many of us, especially like my mother, my grandfather, my grandmother, generations in the past have told us that you have to trust in the lawyer, you have to trust in the doctor and do what they say. And that's fine. But not totally. It's good for you to question things. It's good for you to take these, what we call old attitudes, and get rid of them. And you have a right to know things.
Exactly.
You have a right to research things.
That's right.
You have a right to make up your own mind about your treatment, about your life, and learn your options, okay? So we've been talking about disease and how it takes control of your life for a certain amount of time, as long as you let it take control. Mm-hmm. And then you start gradually taking control over it by questioning your treatment, by learning and making decisions that is right for you. Mm-hmm. So we're going to take it one step further. And we've got Derick and Kimberly back. And I'm so pleased that you're back with us.
Good to see you. Good to be back.
And what we're going to talk about is wellness.
Yes.
Okay. Mm-hmm. We're going to talk about first of all, your business. Your business is not just one business.
No.
It encompasses. It's an umbrella name.
Yes.
That covers several things that you do. Last week we talked about your Reiki.
Yes.
And that's a part of it.
Yes.
And we talked about your photography,
and that's
a part of it.
Yes.
And of course, actually, your Reiki, you have a Reiki Academy, is that correct?
Yes.
Does that mean that you're a Reiki master teacher?
Yes, I am.
So you teach people Reiki?
Yes. So I treat and teach.
And that is part of your business?
Yes.
But this umbrella is basically healthy living and wellness, correct?
Yes, it is.
Yes, that's the basis of it. And the whole idea behind the Brito Center is for people to come together, share ideas, things that they've learned that collectively will help others to ultimately, make better choices, live a better life, be healthier, happier. Mm-hmm. That's the whole idea behind it.
And how does this happen? What do you do?
Well, between my wife and I, my part was the photography because in our former studio, people would come into the waiting area and then they would look at these images and almost instantly relax. People mm-hmm. from other businesses would come and just sit in that space. They would ask us, can I just sit here? And we'd be like, sure, take your time, But that... I didn't see it that way. My wife pointed out to me that, your photography actually helps people. It starts healing through the eyes.
That's
it didn't, it took me a second to understand that. But initially that was my part. And then, as you mentioned, there are other aspects to our business, but we'll get into that a little bit later. You wanted to say something?
Well, we were just... Part of you say, how do we do that?
Mm-hmm.
We
yes.
mentor, train, and coach. So whatever aspect of our business that we're operating in, we find ourselves in those roles.
Mm.
The mentor, trainer, coach. So to help people, to those who are seeking to enrich their lives. So it's just sharing knowledge. And through those collaborations, when we collaborate with folks that are heart-centered, we often find that there are things like the Terry Broder
Breast Cancer Foundation, or Safe Futures.
Safe Futures, yes.
Or perhaps there's something that we collectively want to develop that will then benefit others in need or others that are seeking something new. So we've been invited to be part of different wonderful projects like this show.
Exactly.
And that's how we feel, that we've created a new collaboration here, new friends with whom that are heart-centered and seeking. So it's wonderful.
Now, the first thing, at least in my experience in life, and I'm still a student of life.
Still a student of life.
And I'm an unfinished woman also. I'm all these things. Mm-hmm. But first, with anything with me, is I need to change the attitude first.
Mm. Yes.
Now, how do you approach that with someone new?
Well, first, people need to understand that there are options. You know, just because someone says, this is the way you have to do it, you know, don't have in your spirit or your mind that that's the only way it has to be. You know, mm-hmm. people need to be open-minded. They need to partner with their healthcare professionals and, you know, with people who truly want to partner. Because if you're not okay with certain medications, maybe you want to try a natural way or some holistic avenue, you know, they have to be open to that. And to be honest with you, you know, anybody who has a doctor who isn't, you know, I would maybe start looking for another doctor because, you know, God's pharmacy was first, mm-hmm. and it's still here, and it does work, okay? But, you know, people have to be open to taking responsibility for their own health. And, you know, the reality that there may be help in other forms of treatment.
And but they have to be open to
they
it.
They have to be open to it.
And what do you do if you find resistance? Do you tell them to think about it and then come back when they're ready?
Well, people, again, have to be ready because we've encountered people who've been on the same medications for 20, 30 years. Mm-hmm. Now they're suffering with organ failure, you know, lesions, things that, you know, the situation is now worse. And correct me if I'm wrong, but if you've been using a medication for 20 or 30 years, it's not working. The whole point is to be healed, correct?
Correct. Not maintained.
Not maintained. So, you know, folks, if you've been on medication, the same medication for 20 or 30 years, you might want to look at a holistic avenue or some other alternative because that is not working.
Absolutely. Now, one of the things, though,
it's a
we all
good
have
point.
To be, it is. It's a good point. It makes sense. Common sense. Mm-hmm. And, you know, there's room for common sense in the medical world.
Yes.
But we're not saying that you should throw away your medicine
and then
try a holistic.
Absolutely not.
We're not talking about that.
Absolutely not.
Boom, boom. No.
No. Anybody who is considering an alternative should always work with their doctor. That's where the partnership comes in. Mm-hmm. And if there's an alternative that they might be considering, whether it be a natural product or a different type of therapy, you know, go to your doctor or go to your pharmacist and say, hey, don't ask them, because if it's natural, they're going to tell you no, because
yeah, right.
it kind of goes against what they do.
Taking responsibility.
Exactly. Yeah. So tell them, I'm going to do this. I need you to look it over and tell me if there's anything I should be concerned about. That way, they're not on the hook. Mm-hmm. They will more, you know, probably at that point, give it more of an in-depth investigation before just brushing it aside. So you're kind of giving them the leeway to, you know, be free and not committed. Because, you know, liability reasons, they, you know, those things they have to be concerned about. But just let them know, I'm going to do this. I need you to tell me if there's anything I should be concerned about. And you should get an honest answer.
And you're asking, work with me
work,
on this.
Exactly, mm-hmm. work with me.
Absolutely.
Because my goal is to get better, not just to be maintained.
Maintained, exactly.
Right, and we talk about holistic therapies, mm-hmm. alternative therapies. But the true, in the spirit of what we're talking about,
they're called complementary therapies.
Mm. Yes.
So we're using together, complementing the best of Western as well as alternative or Eastern medicine is even termed.
Right.
So using the best of those to not only restore our health, but to maybe even prevent. To hope to prevent some of those things that have been a family legacy.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
So those are that's where we would steer people. And also toward, I think that we often are referring people who may be a little resistant or not certain about the information we're sharing, is that we may steer them towards some documentaries.
Yes.
Those have been very powerful. They're compelling.
Oh, definitely.
They typically mm-hmm. feature some really well-known medical professionals. And even in some cases, medical professionals who have become, for example, an MD doctor who has become a naturopathic doctor, mm-hmm. who have made those changes, or people who are experts in, right? We have some that are experts in the fields of nutrition and raw nutrition, eating raw foods and that sort of thing. So that's something that we would do. And one of those is Food Matters. Is one of the documentaries that I would suggest for folks to watch. And it starts out with that, clearly setting that foundation of Hippocrates saying, let your food be medicine, and let your medicine be food. So they really give you a firm foundation around that nutrition can heal us. If our bodies are the miracle. If we give our bodies what they need, they will do what they were designed to do, heal.
Absolutely.
Restore, rather than being maintained. So, and I love this quote by David Wolf, who is a raw nutrition expert in the film, Food Matters. He said, it's as easy as this action. We can choose the most nutrient-rich foods, superfoods, or we can choose this toxic soup of prepared foods, GMOs.
Yep.
And the point is, our health and our vitality lie in the balance there. What are we going to choose? So helping people to really those compelling arguments toward that your choices equal your health at the end of the day.
Mm. Now, yes. Is this something that you have been experiencing in the last few years?
Definitely. During chemotherapy, I discovered food as medicine with my lemon water when it was the only thing that would bring my liver enzymes down to continue therapy, which, of course, sort of working with holistic counselors, mm-hmm. I started on my own quest to try and help people discover or learn that food is medicine and we are what we eat.
Exactly.
And we have to take mm-hmm. control, and it's really difficult when it's not so easy to make choices with all the foods that we have around us.
Mm-hmm.
And it takes a lot of convincing. It shouldn't, but it takes a lot of convincing to make people understand that you really are what you eat. And it is out there. If you look at the documentaries mm-hmm. and all the various opinions and studies and so on, it's on a cellular level, they've proven that what you eat goes right to the cells and changes them. And
it replaces what we, what we use, what we burn, what we shed. The food replaces all of those things. And there's a quote that I like to tell people, and it really is as simple as this. Everything that you eat is either fighting or feeding a disease.
Yeah.
So if you think about it in those simple terms,
compelling.
Every single thing you put in your mouth is either fighting or feeding a disease. So you choose.
Oh, that's boy. So which one's better? Fighting disease, obviously.
Fighting. You want to fight it. And that's maintenance, preservation.
What's interesting is when Dawn, for some reason, when you said it, the you know, that it's difficult and it shouldn't be difficult.
It shouldn't.
But this is what the power of these conversations are, is that we can, by stopping to think it through, food is integral to our social gatherings.
Yes.
Do you know, if this was actually our home, would any of us have sat down without saying, well, let's have coffee and tea and cookies? And food has to be there. Yeah. So that, I think, is part of it, and to change a mindset about what that food might be, or the fact that perhaps we don't even need it, just to enjoy each other's company.
That's right.
To just have a cup of tea, like ginger tea, that we were enjoying this week.
Yesterday.
Our ginger
beneficial,
tea.
Beneficial.
Do you know that it was giving us some anti-inflammatory qualities, it's soothing, and it's wonderful to just share with a friend.
Right. Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. So can we change some of those ideas about what's required to be social?
Mm-hmm. Or a treat, for that matter.
Precisely.
Yeah.
Right. Right.
Well, the thing is, you can make healthy treats. You can stock your cabinets with healthier food. But one of the things, and this may be received as a little controversial, but I don't care.
Go for it.
The human being can be very lazy.
Mm.
Okay.
Oh, my goodness.
We're so busy surviving today and just rushing around, and people our age, well, we say, we're retired?
We're retired.
Oh, yeah, sure,
we're retired.
We're busier than ever. Why? Because for me, it keeps me young, keeps me going. But when I think about, oh, yeah, I should eat something, it's like, how long? Then I qualify that by, I have 2 minutes to get something to eat.
Yeah.
I'll grab a cookie, I'll grab a piece of cake, or I'll grab, you know, French fries or something like that. It's reprogramming our minds and our habits and our thinking so that we say, well, I've got 2 minutes. Let me grab a carrot and eat a raw carrot. Let me grab a cup of tea, ginger tea, like I needed yesterday because I had a little bit of the flu. And just, you know, once we get in that groove, once we don't think of it as work to change, so many people say, I gotta change. Oh, that's so much work. It's so hard, I can't do it. Well, you know what? Do you wanna live a long life? Do you wanna be healthy? Do you wanna feel good?
Mm.
Then change.
Change.
Find out what you need to do. Find out what kind of foods are better for you.
Right.
Research, take control.
Absolutely.
Right?
That's taking responsibility.
Exactly.
Absolutely. So if somebody says, okay, all of this makes sense to me, now what do we do? For instance. I come to you and you're changing my attitude and everything you say makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
And I say, okay, so I'm going to change my food, I'm going to talk to the doctor, and I want to lose 35 pounds.
Mm-hmm.
How can I do that? Is there... and I want the easy way out. Okay, see, there we go. There we go. I'm that human being. I'm that great commercial where we open the door and boom, you know, that we are so human.
Yes.
And I don't want the easy way out, okay? I want to lose 35 pounds. That's why I wear black all the time, okay? So Derick and Kimberly, I'm coming to you and I'm saying, okay, my attitude has changed, okay? I'm talking to my doctor, and I happen to have a great doctor. She's wonderful, and she knows who she is. And she trusts me that I've researched things before I come to say, I'd like to try this. Mm. Would that be okay? And she says, yeah, I've researched it too. It makes sense.
Mm.
So that's taken care of, okay? Now, I need to lose some weight. Can you help me do that? And do it sensibly, do it smart.
Mm-hmm. Yes, absolutely.
Mm.
There are several ways to achieve that goal, and your biggest ally is going to be food. How you and how much of it you consume and in what arrangement. It's very important. And we're learning a lot through Dr. Donald K. Lehman, who spent over 30 plus years at the University of Illinois. He came up with a system that will actually eliminate excess body fat. And originally, the plan was, when he first started working on this, from what I understand, is he had athletes in mind. He wanted them to be able to burn fat and build muscle at the same time, because generally with diets, it's one or the other. And then,
yeah,
you lose muscle as well as the excess weight.
Speed recovery time.
Yeah,
speed
you want to speed up recovery.
Is this the father of
metabolism
you're
yes.
talking about?
Yes, the father of metabolism.
Yes. Yes, he is.
Yes.
And the other thing was to speed up recovery. And he achieved all of those things. And what I would suggest someone do if they were considering, you know, losing the excess is to do that system. And generally, in 90-day cycles, people have been able to lose well over 100 pounds. And we know people personally, we're 3 or 4 years later, and they look even better now, and they have all the energy, and they've been able to maintain it. Because it becomes a lifestyle. Once you become educated about food, how much and when to eat, mm-hmm. And then, you know, just like anything else, it's going to take you a little bit to get around the learning curve, and then it becomes habit. You know, was it 30 days to create a habit?
That's funny, because I just wrote that quote from Dr. Lehman's book, was that he had said, you know, using the metabolic system, you get a 90-day window for that learning curve. 30 days creates a habit. 6 months creates a lifestyle.
Mm.
So those things where you're talking about, just reaching for a cookie or even our favorite energy bar is full of preservatives and sugars and lacks the amount of protein that's necessary to fuel these forms. Reading his book is compelling. So if people would like to get a copy of that, they can get in touch with us. And just knowing, understanding how these forms work, how to fuel them, how to keep them vital and healthy throughout a lifetime, and that system, the metabolic system, is a great way to start that learning curve. It's kind of like putting training wheels on and saying, here's the guidebook, I'll just follow this for 90 days, and it will become second nature.
Mm.
You know, so to those things, like when you're saying, well, I'll have carrots instead. Mm-hmm. So what we'd learn is maybe preparing a few things when we go shopping. When we go shopping, wash up. This Derick and I are often, you know, the shopping is not the biggest part of it.
Right.
It's the getting home and then washing up all the fruits and vegetables so you can just grab them.
Mm.
They're ready.
Mm-hmm. And I started doing that actually.
Right.
The health coach in my family is my son-in-law. He's the living example, and he's done so many diets, and he's tried so hard, and I'm sitting there watching him, listening to him on a daily basis, and I'm trying to pick up tips and watch him. So I've cut out breads, I've cut out carbs, I've cut out starches, you know, as much as I possibly can and still live a normal life.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm getting in a habit, and it's been 30 days, so it's a habit, right?
Yes.
Okay. So what I do is I go in the supermarket and I get all these different green salad, you know, different types.
Mm-hmm.
And I come home and I get broccoli and I get all these things that I want my salad. And then I pick up some chicken or something like that to cook and chop up and put in it, because I have to have something more than just greens. I'm not a bunny rabbit.
Mm-hmm.
So what I get, I get home and I get out my baggies and I put three salads at a time in a baggie. I put a little bit of this, a little bit of this, mix it up and make it interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Because there can be nothing more boring than to eat the same thing continually.
Mm-hmm.
So I've started, and I'm very proud of myself for doing
that's
that.
Wonderful.
And thank you to my son-in-law.
Yes.
That's right. It's fantastic.
Now, when you are helping people as a health coach, does this kind of make sense with what you...
Definitely. I would love a copy of that book for myself.
Oh,
what I find people do when they're trying to lose weight, instead of making healthier choices, they think just making reductions, and then it slows the metabolism. They're not getting enough calories for their body, for the metabolism to move and and keep burning and keep going, but I'm not real knowledgeable on that. Can you explain the process of how that, is that sort of what you're talking about with metabolism?
Yes. What we're learning through what Dr. Lehman has put out is that the frequency at which you eat and the combination of your plate is what matters most, because at every meal you should have at least 30 grams of protein, and then you match it with starchy carbs and smart carbs, which would be like your leafy greens or things of that nature. The starchy would be brown rice or beans or something along those lines. But as long as the portions are equal, the process of leucine being created in your muscle tissue will generate growth, and not like bulky or, you know, like our friend Chris.
and he's back there in the control room if you're missing him.
Yeah, no, it's not a matter of becoming like that, but just the muscle fibers. What they do is they become more lean, they become strong, they heal quicker, and they actually use excess, I hate saying the word because sometimes it's offensive to people, but they uses the excess fat as fuel. So you're actually burning fat while you're sleeping.
Oh, my gosh.
Oh, I like that.
It fires up your fat burning, and it's called macro balancing.
Macro balancing.
So when you learn that, and that everything that you eat, not only your meals, as Derick described, but what I learned just recently reading the book was that even the snacks that you consume need to be macro balanced, and in this way you sustain the effects. You're having a life, you've ensured that you'll have a lifetime of health. Metabolism is great for keeping us lean, lean and mean, but it also affects every organ system. Everything in our body is affected by good metabolism. So this is health. This is the lifeline.
On a cellular level, yes.
So it's knowing the macro balancing and getting those, the good organic veggies and side dishes and so forth, understanding how those things affect your body, how they're metabolized by your body, and to create that lifetime metabolism.
Oh my gosh.
I'm going to mess up a lot of people's day right now, and definitely their breakfasts, because we learned in a room of about 2,000 people that if you're trying to manage your weight or maybe shed a few pounds, the worst thing you could do, and this is nothing against the companies that produce this product, bananas.
Yeah, I've heard that.
It's the worst thing you can eat in the morning.
Oops.
Because, and this is why,
exactly.
the glycemic index is so high that it signals your body to store fat for the rest of the day, regardless.
I didn't know that part.
Regardless of activity. So you could go to the gym, sweat your brains out if you ate a banana.
You could make great choices for the rest of the day.
But it doesn't matter because you've already...
Right.
Oh, my
And likewise,
goodness.
If you don't macro balance your meals and your snacks, there are also, likewise, the same effects.
Oh, my goodness.
So that you could make great choices throughout the day. How about something that Derick and I were pretty good at? You're talking about busy lifestyles, is having breakfast, having our lunch at the correct time, and then going hours before dinner. Hours and hours. We just ruined all the effects of the good choices we made all day.
Because of slowing metabolism?
Because you've waited too long.
Waited too long.
There is a timing to it, and there's a science to it. So.
Oh, my goodness.
You know what? I would love to have you continue for the rest of the evening. Here we go
again. It's fascinating.
But I've got a couple of announcements to make.
Yes,
and
yes.
I would love a copy of that book too. Okay.
So if you want more info, they can email us.
If you want more info, there's an email address. That's right. For Derick, and he will get in touch with him. These guys know a lot of things. They're learning a lot of things.
Students.
And students of
students
life.
Of students, life.
We're all
of life.
Students of life. And I'm just going to make a few announcements here before I say the final thank
Fabulous.
You.
Fabulous.
Next week, we're going to continue Healthy Choices, okay? We're going to have Dr. Jamie Lee on.
Nice.
And she's wonderful. She and I could talk about very similar things, but we're going to focus on thermography and as an alternative test that actually tells you what your body's doing and what's going on in your body even before you get symptoms. Very cool. I'm going to get it done. And also we're going to talk about green sustainable energy and its effect on your health. And the next week, March 19th and 20th, the conversation with Safe Hopes or Safe Futures, which was the Women's Center of Southeastern Connecticut. And the week after that, we're going to be doing unique sports. And the week after that, we're going to have Autism Speaks. Mm. And it just continues on and on. We've got a lot of good shows coming up, so stay with us for that. Now, there's a couple of more announcements of upcoming events. On April 12th, mark that down, 10 to 4, Craft and Author Show at the VFW Post in Pawcatuck. Contact Tom Santos. I think we've got his phone number, and there it is. And then there's, let's see, the rest is pretty much a repeat of last week, so you got to go to last week's show to get those, because we're starting to run out of time. This was wonderful. Thank you so much, Derick, Kimberly, and Dawn, my wonderful co-host, the hostess with the mostest.
Thank you. Glad to be here.
And Chris, thank you for being in the control room for us this week.
Yay.
I appreciate it very much. And please come back and join us next week with Dr. Jamie Lee. It's going to be a great show. And if you missed the show, we're right on YouTube. From This Corner TV, all smushed together, no spaces, and you will find us. Thank you for joining us today. See you next week.